two decades later, 7 years in the making, new passengers is here, and so is what Gail Sheehy calls a second adulthood. I just say second childhood because I was thinking of myself. A second adulthood in the Middle East. Gail, nice to see you. I know you've been out on a book tour. Do we have a picture of the book? Did we show the book on the screen already? Okay, I want them to see this. New passages. There it is. Mapping Your Life Across Time. Now, rather than me try to sound intelligent asking a bunch of questions, tell me about the transition from passages to new passages.
Well, I started out to write a sequel, thinking I'd pick up where I left off in the original book at 50, because I was doing research for that original book. I was in my mid-30s, and I simply thought, well, there isn't any life after 50. Then I got there and said, guess what?
I'm still alive.
I'm still alive, and even though I had to go through a pretty confused and sometimes difficult passage, as I was working my way through it, I realized from all the interviews that I was doing and the data I was collecting that there had been a revolution.
Are you a different person today than you were in your 30s? What has changed about you?
Oh, a great deal. I mean, primarily the perspective. That's what changes with all of us. I mean, at 35, as I say, I really thought that the deadline of life was 40, 45, and that after that it was just kind of set and safe and coasting.
Get your Social Security check, sit around.
Well, kind of prepare to, move on to your just desserts and kind of hold your own as long as you can, and then and it's not that way today. I mean, but there was a revolution in the entire life cycle, and I started with the 20s and found them to be delayed. You know, adolescence lasts till 30 today.
At least. There are people on the staff who are well into their 30s and still very childlike.
and then first adulthood starts about 30, and it takes us to about 45. And we're dependent upon, women on their beauty and their fertility as their primary sources of identity, and men on their success and on their athletic prowess and on their hair. And then when we start losing those things as our primary source of identity, we go through what I call a little death. That sometimes happens.
But we could show this on here, actually. I don't know if you can get a shot of this, but this sort of lays it out. Go back through this. This was the, I don't have my glasses on. See, because I'm in my 50s, I'm having a little trouble. Okay. 18 to 30, provisional
adulthood. Yes, that's sort of the tryout for adulthood.
Right, that's true. Okay, first adulthood.
It's when people now at 30 start taking on their, really making a commitment in their career.
So Hugh Grant is sort of in here somewhere, this provisional. He's trying out and he blew it, or whatever you want to call it. The first adulthood is here.
And that takes us through from the turbulent 30s into halfway through the flourishing 40s.
Okay.
And then around 45, mid-40s, we get into this middle essence. You know, when I interviewed people who were in their mid-40s, men and women across the country, and I would bring up the subject of middle age, it was as if I was talking a foreign language. I mean, they're just not having it.
Now,
middle age has no meaning for them because they feel differently. Middle age is really a set of stereotypes, and it doesn't fit most people in their mid-40s today. They're healthier, they're going to live, 30 years longer than people did at the beginning of the century. The healthy ones are going to live 40 years longer, and they have so much life ahead of them that they don't yet feel that tremendous sense of time pressing and immortality.
Go back here a second. Now, you get into a second adulthood about what age?
About 50. You have a rebirth. You know, there's this little death, and then you come through this big...
What happens to you during the little death? Do you get depressed?
Well, some people do. For many women, there's the symptoms of perimenopause and then menopause, and that whole huge physical change precipitates a lot of...
You think, I can't have babies anymore and I'm finished, kind of?
Well, that's part of it, although that's beginning to change very, very rapidly.
And a lot of women in their 40s are having babies.
They are having babies. In fact, one of them I interviewed in or talked to in a yoga class said, I'm so glad I finished breastfeeding just in time for menopause. And men often feel they don't want to make a passage to 50. They want to hang on to what they had, especially the successful ones. And they don't like to pay attention to the fact that they can't, take their health for granted anymore. And they won't go to doctors. And if they do, they won't ask questions and so on. So the there's a sense of kind of hanging on, whereas women have to take the notice of the menopausal change, so they often have a little head start in moving into the second adulthood and recognizing it as a phase of incredible opportunity and adventure, playfulness. You know, first adulthood just happens to us, but second adulthood we can custom design.
And you don't have quite the responsibilities either, usually. You don't have little children at that point you're trying to raise.
Little children, unless you started a second family.
Right.
You know, the mortgage is probably pretty nearly paid up. You know how to do what you do. You know what your defenses are. You know what your weaknesses are. You understand the world a whole lot better. And you also have a time limit that's very clear now. And that makes everything that you do have more meaning. And that's why I call it the meaning crisis. That's one of the things that happens in this passage. There's a meaning crisis. There may be a mortality crisis. Because sometime in the 50s, most of us will, with ourselves...
Somebody we know dies.
Somebody we know dies or gets real sick.
Right.
And we have to go through...
This is the most fascinating thing to me on the chart, the bridge, the passage to the age of integrity. Tell me about that, because I happen to notice that Bill Clinton was at 48, which is back here. He hasn't hit this bridge yet. But the age of integrity, what does that mean?
Okay, it doesn't mean that we're all liars before we get to the age of integrity.
But it does
okay?
mean we may tell the truth sometime in the future. Is that what it means?
It actually,
we have hope, in other words.
It actually means that we integrate all that we have learned and what the people were at the subtotal stage. We're talking now about the mid-60s into the 70s, where people really say, what would my life add up to? What have I done with my life? Am I proud? Is this the legacy I want to leave? What kind of reconciliations might I make, parent or enemies?
Are we better people there than we were before?
Many people are. Many people who get it are. And there's all kinds of opportunities for things in what I call the harmonizing 60s that I was amazed to find during my research. The mature love, which is actually the most important ingredient for men.
Forgive me, Gail. I have to take a break. We're going to go to a break. We're with Gail Sheehy. We'll be right back with new passages. Stay with us. This is about you. I heard that you made so much money you started building. Well, not that you wouldn't feel guilty. You're a liberal. I mean, you felt guilty because you made so much money, you started giving it away. Is that true?
Yes, it is true.
It is true?
It's embarrassing, but true, yes. Well, I didn't make so much money. I just had never made any money before.
So all of a sudden it started coming in and you started to say, gee, it's more than I need. That's actually a very nice problem.
Wasn't that. It was not more than I needed.
I noticed you didn't call me and give me any.
Didn't know you then.
Okay.
The problem was, I thought, what I'm about is learning and knowing and writing. I'm not a success machine. Now I have this book that's on top of the bestsellers. People are going to think I just was trying to be a commercial book writer. And then they
Three
began...
3 years is a long time to have a book.
Well, I know. I couldn't help it. Sorry.
You know what occurs to me about this? That this actually, folks, is a very hopeful chart about your life. A lot of people see life as diminishing as you get older. If you look at the lines of this chart, it just occurs to me that it broadens and therefore opportunities increase as you get older, provided you can take advantage of them and not let it get into your head that somehow it's going the other way. It's just
very perceptive.
Yeah.
And you know where I got the idea for this chart? It was done by a marvelous graphic artist, but the idea for it came from the Steinberg poster of New York, you know, where it's Fifth Avenue,
right,
57th
right.
Street, and then there's sort of Little Rock in
right.
Asia. And,
right.
well, I wanted to show how much longer second adulthood is and how much more colorful and varied it is than first adulthood, which is all we pay attention to in this country, the youth culture. And so that's why this first adulthood is just the green area, and then the second adulthood is this huge, unmapped expanse. And in my view, this is the new frontier. You know, we had...
But why do advertisers, I know even on this network, which I think is a mistake, but on all networks, the advertisers only count people between 18 and 54 years of age. After you're 54, you become irrelevant to advertisers as far as television.
Absolutely. One of my biggest peaks, and actually it's 18 to 49, as far as I know.
Yeah.
And
well, they've moved it up a little bit.
Have they? To 54, they're
dead.
And then after 55, you're dead.
Oh, you're dead.
Right. But, you know, this is crazy, because today, are getting remarried in their 40s and 50s. They're starting their families in their 40s, often getting remarried and starting over again, start over dads in their 50s and 60s, you know, egg donor babies in their 50s and 60s. Then there, women are exploding at with adventure, going back to college, going to graduate school, traveling, you know, buying cars. Men are, we're living so much longer that from 50.
I know, the advertising community's got to catch up here and figure out that the people over 45, 55 years of age have some money to spend.
They have a lot on the disposable income in this country.
Right.
They control 55% of the disposable income in this country. And they're spending it because most of them recognize, although they might have not had the words for it, that there is this second adulthood that opens up for them, and they're free to do what they consider important and, you know, fun.
Tell me about the Clintons. I was kidding about them earlier. Now we're going to treat it seriously. I won't kid about them.
All right. We'll be serious. Now, I think that they are making a passage into from first to second adulthood and through middle-essence while they're occupying the most important positions in the country.
Wouldn't this argue that we should do what European countries do and wait until a man or a woman is in their late 50s or 60s before we elect them, because they're still in some form of transition? They haven't reached, I was kidding about this,
yeah,
age of integrity and so on, but I mean, in a sense, foreign leaders have always been older than our leaders.
That's true.
And maybe we need older leaders who have more perspective. Is that
well, we're a country that believes in youth. Youth and change. And, you know, young, fresh ideas. So it's very likely we will continue to look to people who are in their 40s, although now we're looking to Dole, and Dole is an old, tried-and-true World War II hero. It's another...
Last of that era.
Back to that generation,
right,
that held power in this country for 40 years. But I think what's human about the Clintons and what really illustrates what I'm talking about in this book is something that people never paid attention to while they're evaluating them. Just while they've been in office, they've had some of the life accidents that are very common at this time of life. Bill lost his last remaining parent. That's an accident of great moment for all of us. Hillary Clinton lost her father. They entered middle-essence at the same time as their child entered adolescence,
mm-hmm,
which is happening more and more today because people postpone having children. And then, finally, the illusions that they brought from first adulthood into the White House, which is once I get there, once I reach the top, everything will be realized. All my dreams will be realized. Of course, it never happens, and it just never happens bigger in the White House because they're buffeted by all of the mistakes and all of the, you know, forces that swirl around them. So they have both, I think, been through very, very dark times, very angry times, and they had to now remake themselves after this little death, if they may have gone through that. And I think my sense is that may be what they're in the process of doing.
In fairness to the Clintons, I must say that going through all this personally, we forget that the president and the first lady in this country are real people. They have, like, their real lives. They've got a problem. They've got Chelsea. They've got the school. They've got all these other things going on, their parents' death and all that sort of thing. And they're also trying to run the country and be a symbol. And it's not an easy job. We'll be back right after these messages. New Passages, the name of the book.